I don't know about you, but I've been fortunate enough to take this stuff completely for granted for my entire life. And that is, of course, because I was lucky enough to be born in one of the richest nations on Earth, geographically situated on the eastern side of a large ocean, at a latitude that provides a temperate climate and plenty of precipitation throughout the year. So here in the UK, we've got loads of water in reservoirs and subterranean aquifers all over the place. But according to UNICEF, 1 in 4 people globally doesn't have safe drinking water in their homes, and nearly half the world's population lacks safely managed sanitation. As the climate emergency continues to spiral out of control, that situation will get increasingly worse unless very strong action is taken in the very near future to address these sorts of challenges. According to the World Bank, in many of the hottest and driest regions across 150 countries, desalination of seawater is the only thing keeping about 300 million people alive. In 2017, the global cumulative desalination capacity exceeded 100 million cubic meters per day. And that's still nowhere near enough to provide every human with a safe daily supply. We could really do with increasing the amount of desalination by at least an order of magnitude. But the trouble is, current technologies consume a huge amount of energy and produce very high levels of greenhouse gas emissions. But now, a team at the Australian National University has come up with a desalination system that reduces energy consumption by 80% and can easily be deployed in remote areas. So how do they do that then? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Before we get stuck in, I just want to say thank you to the thousands of folks who subscribed to the channel in the last few weeks. We're edging slowly towards the 600,000 subscriber mark here at Just Have a Think, and it would really be amazing to get there during the second half of 2024. So if you haven't already done so, you really would be hugely supporting me and the channel if you could hit that free subscribe button and click on all notifications. And by the way, the folks at YouTube have informed me that their algorithm has been incorrectly unsubscribing people recently. So if you haven't been getting notifications and you've been wondering why, you might want to double check that you are definitely still subscribed to the channel. Anyway, desalination then. Well, it's a very mature and well understood industry, isn't it? Humans have been distilling fresh water from seawater since Aristotle first mentioned it in the 4th century BC. The two main methods employed today are thermal distillation, where seawater is heated up and evaporated so that the salt separates out and the vapour can be condensed back out into fresh water, or reverse osmosis, where the seawater is forced through a semi-permeable membrane that only allows water molecules through and blocks all other impurities. Both those methods are energy intensive, either for high temperature heat or for very high pressure. Reverse osmosis uses something like 3 or 4 kilowatt hours of electricity to produce a cubic meter of water, and thermal distillation can consume more than 15 kilowatt hours per cubic meter. The goal of the team at ANU was to find a method that could be easily set up and maintained in remote off-grid areas where the need is often the greatest. And it might not surprise you to learn that the alternative source of energy they turned to was the large nuclear fusion reactor in the sky that we call the sun. But unlike the vast open-air evaporation ponds in places like the Salar de Atacama in Chile, where intense sunlight can take months to slowly evaporate water out of brine solutions, the Aussie scientists needed something a bit quicker to cope with the daily imperative of human water consumption. The method investigated in this latest research paper is something called thermodiffusive desalination, or TDD. It's a technique that doesn't involve any energy-hungry phase changes or expensive and high-maintenance membranes or adsorbing materials. The basic components of the system are 2 hollow nickel-plated copper panels arranged horizontally and parallel to each other. The bottom panel is cooled by incoming water flowing across its upper and lower surfaces, while the top panel is exposed to sunlight, which causes it to get hot. The authors of the paper also mention that waste industrial heat could be a good alternative to sunlight if there was a suitable facility nearby. Anyway, the science bods call this kind of setup a vertical positive temperature gradient. A solution of salt water is allowed to flow between the 2 panels, and for rather convoluted reasons of physics that we won't go into here, The ionic components of the water are attracted to the cold panel at the bottom, leaving fresher water to flow along the warm panel at the top. There's a sciencey name for this as well, of course. It's called thermophobic transport. The result is what the paper's authors describe as a negative concentration gradient. You also get an increasingly negative density gradient from the thermal stratification, and that helps to minimise any mixing from what would otherwise be a more turbulent flow. At the end of the unit, the so-called thermodiffusive separated solution is split into two streams via a simple spacer, and each stream is sent into its own collection bottle. To keep things as simple as possible, the researchers first used a sodium chloride and water mix without any of the other impurities that are typically found in real seawater. And to give themselves some kind of benchmark data, they just passed that salty water through the system once. In the laboratory experimental rig, the hot and cold panels were just a millimetre apart, with a temperature difference between them of 37 degrees Celsius. The total flow distance was 500 millimetres, and the flow rate of water was 16 millilitres per minute. Under those conditions, they actually achieved a maximum concentration difference of 900 parts per million, which is nowhere near removing the roughly 30,000 parts per million typically found in seawater, and certainly nothing like enough to obtain low salinity water useful for agriculture, which needs to be about 95% salt-free, and which actually accounts for almost 70% of global water consumption. So the team ran the outlet water through the system several more times, each time discarding the contents of the high concentration outlet bottle and just recirculating the contents of the low concentration outlet bottle. Clearly you get a rapidly diminishing volumetric return with a method like this, but the team were able to bump up the concentration drop from 900 to 2000 parts per million. Still not really good enough. But the paper's authors reckon they know a way to smooth out that little wrinkle. They proposed and assessed a cascaded structure where a single flow passes through a multi-channel device. And that way you keep the volume, but get lots more desalination. Once they crunched the numbers for that theoretical setup, they calculated a concentration drop of more than 25,000 parts per million with a recovery rate of 10%, which is a much more meaningful and useful number that would actually be genuinely usable in the real world. And let's not forget the major benefits of the system. Firstly, the whole process is operated in the liquid phase of water. There's none of the energy-hungry phase change that takes place in evaporative designs. There's also no external pressure required like there is in reverse osmosis, so there's a bunch of energy saved there too. The test results showed that the electrical energy required to produce 1 cubic meter of water with a concentration drop of 25,000 parts per million is less than 3 watt-hours, which is only a tiny fraction of the energy consumption of existing methods that I mentioned earlier on. Secondly, there's no reliance on any functional materials like membranes or ion adsorbents that need costly regular maintenance to avoid extensive material degradation. And by the way, the experiments that the Aussie team carried out were run intermittently across an entire year. And thanks to the nickel plating on the copper panels, there was no visible corrosion from the salt water. Last but not least, thermodiffusion is driven by relatively low temperature heat that can be sourced from readily available sources, including industrial waste or solar irradiation, or even just the surrounding environment, all of which makes this system ideal for regions with plenty of sunshine, but not such good access to electrical grids. There are some challenges though, for example, the trade-off between yield and heat flux between the two panels. The best yields are achieved when the panels are closest together, but of course you get a much better difference in temperature between the panels when they're further apart. So a balance has to be struck there. And for yet more reasons of physics that are outside the scope of this video, thermodiffusive separation has a fundamental limit indicated by something called the mass flux equation, which tells us that you get a very rapid drop-off in yield as the concentration of feed water decreases. The paper's authors suggest that more work needs to be done to better understand the fundamental mechanism behind thermodiffusion so that more effective strategies can be devised. But nevertheless, even in this current iteration, thermodiffusive separation could already represent an extremely useful low-energy precursor to existing technology in some sort of hybrid desalination facility, and it could prove to be a very efficient and effective way of dealing with brine or industrial wastewater that contains high concentrations of pollutants, most of which have been shown to separate out of the water in the same thermophobic way. So, you know, it's very much a work in progress. But as our global quest for accessible fresh water continues to get more challenging in the coming years, smart solutions like this may well play an important role in optimising the way we eke out the resources available to us. Now, I'm conscious that there are other alternative desalination methods in development that we haven't mentioned in this video. So if you're involved in one of those projects, or if you just have feedback or views that you want to share on this particular technology, then as always, the place to leave your thoughts is in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. A massive thank you, as always, to our amazing Patreon supporters who keep this channel completely independent and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. And I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Jay Taylor, Richard, Dimitri, Call Me, probably not their real name, Mark Rowe, Richard Corcoran, and Michael Link. If you'd like to support my work here at the channel and get involved with other like-minded folks, then you can do just that by visiting patreon.com/justhaveathink. And of course, you can hugely support us and help us get to that 600,000 subscriber mark by hitting the free subscribe button on YouTube. Doesn't cost a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away, either down there somewhere or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.